Oh, thank you so much for joining me on peoplesinternetradio.com. Today's Wednesday, February the 15th. And it's a couple of weeks ago that you spoke at a rally outside of City Hall here in New York City. And the rally was, people were very angry at, so-called Mayor Bill de Blasio, asking him or demanding that he step down. And you are running for mayor of New York?
That's correct.
Okay, you are presently running.
Correct.
Okay, so just talk a little bit about that rally and what it was about and what you spoke about.
Well, the rally was about, many neighborhoods throughout the entire city that are being gentrified by the mayor's relationship with the real estate industry, allowing luxury developments to go on in many communities and pushing out the very people who need affordable housing. This is an issue that I've worked on for many years, going back to my days in the city council and now in the state senate. And one of the main reasons I'm running for mayor against de Blasio is that this has to stop. People need affordable housing in this city. We don't need more luxury housing. We have plenty of that. When we do a development, we need to do it in such a way that we help the people who need affordable housing in the very community where that development is going to go on. Not that we allow the real estate industry to build these luxury, developments and push out the people from their own neighborhood. I mean, that's just a disgrace, and this is something that has to change in the city of New York. And that was, you had hundreds of people at this rally expressing this very issue and their concerns about this.
Yeah, so since then, since I met you there, I did two interviews of Robert Hernandez of, El Barrio, the people up in Spanish Harlem, and he talked about, his fight and how the people up there, like so many people, have been already forced to leave the neighborhood. And then, People First, another group called People First, a group from, I believe it was Chinatown and the Lower East Side, who were also part of that rally.
That's correct. And it points out that this problem is occurring in every community in the city. And one of the things that I think needs to be a change is, if you ask people in the city where they live, they don't say, "I live in New York City." They may say the borough, but most likely they're going to say the neighborhood that they live in. And we do very little as a city to preserve the character and quality of each neighborhood. And each neighborhood is distinctive. And it is just outrageous that we can allow these developments to go on and, these real estate developers to make huge amounts of money and push out middle-class, low-income families who have lived in their neighborhood probably for all their lives, and now they can't find another place to live. One of the things that absolutely has to change is, and this is a crucial part of where de Blasio has failed, he talks about affordable housing, but all he's doing is allowing developers to build luxury housing. And even when they put an affordable housing component in these developments, it's not affordable to the people who live in that particular community. One of the things that I've advocated for a long time is to change the concept and the formula that dictates what affordable housing is. The city has always relied on what is called the area median income, AMI, which is the average income for everybody in the city and also Putnam County. It's artificially inflated, and it doesn't represent the average median income in particular neighborhoods, so that when we allow a developer to say, "Oh, we're going to do 80% of AMI, the affordable housing component," most likely that's still too high, too expensive for the people in that community. It's very interesting that we're having this conversation today, because today I introduced legislation in the Senate to change that system and instead create the average median income for each zip code, so that if we do a development in a particular zip code, the affordable housing component has to be based on the median income for that neighborhood. That's when we can really do affordable housing. That will ensure that the people in that community benefit from the development and not pushed out of their own neighborhood.
In the interview that I did with Robert Hernandez, I mean, he was also making the point that it's the people who live there, a lot of them are also immigrants that made the neighborhood in the first place, like very, like they're the ones that built the neighborhood, that made it an attractive place, that kept it up, you know, so then now that they can be like booted out of it.
That's very true. It's those residents, and in this case, minority residents, who in effect made that neighborhood advantageous for the developers. And then what happens is they get pushed out of their own community. It's a real disgrace.
I mean, this is really, I interview a lot of people, and it's really unfortunate, like, what is allowed to go on in this country, and that so many people, in political offices are just selling out the people.
Unfortunately, the political system that we have, not only in the city, the state, and the federal level, money moves the system. We have to take back government, and it should be the people that run government. I mean, as a council member, as a state senator, I work for the people. I don't work for the rich.
Exactly.
And that's something that's got to change. And the issue we're talking about, gentrification, is a perfect example of why money moves the system, especially in state government. And that has to change.
So let me just ask, because it must be extremely difficult within the political system, and I know that you have to have ridiculous amounts of money to even run for a political office. How do you do it? Like, how do you really, you know what I mean?
It's a good question. I wish I had a good answer for that. All I can tell you is, I made a commitment to myself when I first ran for public office that I was never going to sell my soul to raise the money to run for office. And I've kept that, promise to myself. I rely on people who believe in what I do, my record, and my vision for my district, the city, the state. And so far, people have been forthcoming. But it's too easy for politicians to accept the donations from the really rich and powerful. And that's how the system is corrupted.
So that's what I'm saying. So, how is that not just completely illegal to just be bought?
Well, we in the city we have campaign finance program. We get matching funds. The state has no such regulation. There are rules in Congress where there are loopholes that allow the rich and powerful to get around it. Even with the city's campaign finance program, one of my friends who I've been working with over a number of years to change the system to eliminate big donations completely did an analysis that showed in 2009 when people were running for mayor, public advocate, controller, the number of donations at the higher end of the donation level as opposed to the lower donations, smaller donations, still far outweighed the small donations. So it's big money still moves the system. And I believe what has to happen is a total public matching program. And you're limited to small donations. from individuals, and that's it. And then you get, you know, you get public matching dollars in return. In my opinion, that's the only way we eliminate the big, the rich and powerful from influencing the system.
You know, I did a lot of filming and documenting stuff when the Occupy Wall Street movement was taking place, and the, you know, money in politics was like a big issue, and you know, money is free speech and corporations are people and all this, like, you know, just completely made up. You know, people that are, I mean, these people are like just intoxicated on, you know, profit or whatever, that they just kind of want to make up these crazy rules where they can just kind of do whatever they want. So, right, like making corporations not be people and having the same rights as people, Citizens United and all of that, like reversing that. I mean, what do you say to that?
No, I think the Supreme Court in its decision allowing corporations to donate was a huge blow to democracy, because corporations have unlimited dollars.
I mean, it's outrageous.
It really is. It was a serious blow to elections and democracy.
And, you know, again, just speaking of the banks and the crisis of 08, where nobody's been held accountable, and a couple of people that I've interviewed have actually said that the banks are even larger today than they were since the crash of 08.
That's correct. That's correct.
I mean, you know, I last week I interviewed William K. Black. He was actually involved in putting bankers in jail during the SNL crisis of the 80s. And, you know, so he was talking about, repealing, of course, putting back into place Glass-Steagall, the Dodd-Frank bill that they pretty much spun the, you know, the heck out of that to literally drown it from being able to really do what it was meant to do, and also the Volcker rule. So, you know, right, like just holding banks accountable, regulating them, disciplining them. I mean, it's like they're like children that need some severe discipline, and there are no, it doesn't seem to be anybody with the spine to do it.
Well, again, how do most politicians get elected to office? By taking the money from the, you know, whether it's the banking industry, the real estate industry, the insurance industry. I mean, I can go on and on and on. We have to start helping real candidates, you know, get elected with small donations. Look at my own campaign for mayor. I mean, my website is avellaformayor.com. I'm relying on people to make small donations to my campaign. Otherwise, I can't win.
Right.
But if everybody gets involved and makes small donations, we outnumber the rich and powerful.
Exactly.
By huge numbers. But it's, you know, all too often, you know, I see a lot of people in the street who are telling me, oh, I'm going to vote for you. And I say to them, that's great, but before you can vote for me, I need to get on the ballot, and I need to raise money to do that.
So
people need to get more involved in candidates that are not representing the interests of the rich and powerful.
Okay, so
we can change the system.
So here's a good place to interject the last presidential election that we had, and, you know, because a lot of times it really seems like, I mean, I know a lot of people liked Bernie Sanders a lot, and then he got screwed. But people voting for people that they don't want to vote for just to not vote for someone that's worse than the other person. And then also people saying that, you know, Jill Stein kind of messed things up because she's going to, you know, make people vote for somebody that they don't want. You know, I mean, to me, it just makes sense, right, to vote your conscience. And to say, like, oh, you know, don't vote for somebody because they can't possibly win. You know, so thinking about you and your running, you know, candidacy, the people need to own their power. I mean, how else are you gonna win if people don't support you? It's kind of like, it's like people want some guarantee that that you're gonna win before they're on your side, when it's actually them being on your side is what's gonna help you to win.
That's so very true. I couldn't have said it better myself.
You know what I mean? It's like,
yeah.
You know, I think of it the same way that I think of, like, child rearing. I mean, no, you know, it's the parent, the person, you know, the adult that's supposed to instill and raise and cultivate, you know, the child to be and you know, healthy, successful, well-adjusted. And a lot of times, you know, it's like it can start to go the other way around.
If people, the average resident, the average citizen of this city, got involved and started, you know, helping candidates like myself.
Exactly.
We could change this city overnight in one election.
I mean, yeah.
But it's too easy. Unfortunately, too many people, like, I understand, you know, today everybody's working. We work longer hours than we have in a long, long time. Mm-hmm. It's harder to meet, you know, your finances from week to week. But you got to take a little bit of time and a little bit of money to donate to candidates who are of the community. And that's how we change the system, and not letting somebody else do the work and do the job. Because if we don't get involved, the candidates who don't represent our interests, who are taking money from the rich and powerful and the special interests, are going to win every time.
So that's what I'm saying. It's in order to break the vicious cycle, the people need, you know, because I mean, I'm always saying this, like, the people really need to own their power. Like, the people, they really don't act in their own best interest. Like, they're not on their own side. So it just ends up perpetuating that they act in ways that are against their own interest, and then kind of find excuses why they can't, you know, develop better habits that are going to be in their own interest. I mean, I just think of it like a diet and exercise program, right? You hear people say, like, oh, I'm working all day, yada, 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 like, I don't have time to go to the gym. And me, it was like, nothing was gonna keep me from going to the gym. It's like, you have to make the time in order to take and steer things in the direction that you want it to go in, because as long as you just keep the vicious cycle going, exactly, you're just propping up the very people that are undermining you.
Correct.
And,
correct.
You know, because, right, I mean, I'm sure people don't want to just be having these sort of dead-end jobs or whatever that aren't going to take them anywhere indefinitely. You know, yeah, like empowering the little guy, like you, and you in turn empower them.
Absolutely. This election, I think, affords us an opportunity that hasn't come along in a long time to really change the system. De Blasio has very high negatives. Some of the other big names are not going to jump into the race because they're not going to give up their seats to run. So here we have, you know, I mean, I'm a candidate who's tried to set an example. I've been a good government candidate since I was first elected to public office. I started as a civic activist. My only reason for running is to help my city, my state, my country, and to do the right thing. I could care less about political considerations. I do what I think is right, based upon my own conscience and the people I represent. And unfortunately, we don't have a lot of people in office like that.
Right.
So I hope your listeners will visit my website, avellaformayor.com, and hopefully they'll be interested in getting involved.
So, okay, there it is. You heard it. It's Tony Avella, A-V-E-L-L-A. You said it was TonyAvella.com?
No, it's AvellaForMayor.com.
Okay. AvellaForMayor.com. So if I could just say this one last thing to you before you go. I kind of couldn't understand why they had a big rally down at Battery Park over the immigration, keeping the immigrants out. And they had de Blasio speaking at that event. And I was like, why are they doing that?
They're being misinformed that he's got this narrative that he's the true progressive. And yet, his whole administration is the exact opposite.
So that's what I'm saying. Don't people, because he's actually being under investigation for his big real estate dealings, isn't he?
Correct, yeah. There are a number of investigations going on. It's my understanding there's a grand jury that's been convened.
Yeah.
That's why I think his negatives are so high. But I think people like you and I, who are more involved in the system and know what's going on, can appreciate that his whole campaign promises were just a lie. Unfortunately, the average person who doesn't pay as much attention as we do may be fooled by his rhetoric.
Mm. Okay, so again, be on the lookout. It's AvellaForMayor.com. Yeah, I appreciate it. And we definitely have to stop these stupid luxury condos. I mean, because there's not even anybody to fill them. And then you're going to have to commit more crimes so you'll make more so-called rich people in order to fill these buildings.
True. Well, thanks for having me on your show. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to your listeners.
Okay, you too. Thank you.
Take care.
Okay, good night.